Hey, everybody, and welcome to Chef AJ Live. I'm your host, Chef AJ, and this is where I introduce you to amazing people just like you who are doing great things in the world. And today's guest, she is doing so many great things. You're just going to not believe all the things she's up to. If you haven't heard of her, well, then you are going to have the best time because she's amazing. I've known her for many years. We had the privilege of speaking together in Texas a long time ago. And if you participated in the Holistic Holiday at Home, she gave an amazing talk there in the Q&A. Her name is Tracye McQuirter. She wrote a book called By Any Greens Necessary and another one called Ageless Vegan that she's going to talk about. Please welcome Tracye to the show. You are beautiful, by the way.
Oh, thank you, AJ. So are you. I'm trying to keep up.
Well, I look at some of the pictures of you and like, did you ever do modeling? Because I mean, you really.
For a hot second.
Okay. Yeah. I wasn't just saying that to make you feel good. When I look at some of the pictures on your website, I'm like, this looks like a modeling shot. Like they're gorgeous.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah,
absolutely. Well, Robert Cheek, he's tuned in. So, you know, you've got some fans. So you are up. You are up to some great things, but one of the things I think that is so fun about you is you wrote a book with your mom. That must have been a great experience.
Oh, it was. So that was the Ageless Vegan book that came out. The latest book came out in 2018, and we did write that together. In 2018, we were celebrating 30 years of being vegan around that time. And so I wanted to do something special with my mom. I don't think that there had been a mother-daughter vegan kind of story like ours in book form. Or if there were, you know, not that many. And so I wanted to add to that. And my mom started when she was 50. Now she's now 84. I started when I was 20. I will be 54 next month. So yeah, we just wanted to celebrate that.
Well, that's amazing. And I told you right before we came on, I'd love to interview her. I recently interviewed the wife of Jack LaLanne, Elaine LaLanne, who's 94 and still lifts weights every day. And you know, your mom is just such a testimonial, and as are you, that what you eat and whether or not you move your body, it really does make a difference to aging.
It really does. And my mother in particular, for sure. I mean, she, you know, before COVID, she was exercising 6 days a week, twice a day, yoga, aerobics, Pilates, weight training, Tai Chi at her senior center, along with teaching quilting at her senior center once a week and walking every day. So she's been doing that for decades. And that, you know, even before she went vegan. So that hasn't changed. And that absolutely has made a big difference in, you know, her maintaining, my mom being able to maintain her health into her senior years. Her doctors say that she has the health markers of someone who's in her 50s.
That's incredible. Gosh, I can't wait to meet her. Well, so how did you get started 30 years ago on your vegan journey, Tracye?
Well, I, you know, originally it was my mom who planted the seed for healthy eating. When we were growing up in DC, we were omnivores, but she was health conscious. So we had, you know, healthier food, but I hated it. And I liked junky food as a kid. And so when I went to Amherst College in my sophomore year in 1986, our Black Student Union brought Dick Gregory to campus, and we knew him as a civil rights legend, as a comedic genius, but we did not know that he had been vegan for 20 years by that time, and that was because of the practice of nonviolence during the civil rights movement. He was a right-hand person to King. He actually gave up his comedy career so that he could be a political activist. So that nonviolence practice, he extended to animals, and then to become a vegetarian. And then 1967, he became a vegan for health reasons, sparked by the partnership that he had with Dr. Alvinia Fulton, who was a naturopathic physician, a Black woman who opened the first vegan cafe and health food store in the South Side of Chicago in 1958. So she helped him go vegan for health reasons in 67. So by the time he came to my campus in 86, he had been vegan for 20 years. He had a vegan empire selling products and things. We knew nothing about that. And I certainly knew nothing about it, was not interested in healthy eating. And I had gained 25 pounds my first year. I was eating hamburgers and hot dogs and pizzas every day. And so instead of talking about the political and economic and social state of Black America, he talked about the political, economic, and social plate of Black America. And he made all of these connections about not only animals, but food justice. I mean, back in the 80s, you know, the USDA, the federal government, the food industry. And so I was interested in all of these subjects. And so, the fact that he tied them to food just kind of blew my mind. And he traced the path of a hamburger from a cow on a factory farm through the slaughterhouse to a fast food restaurant to a clogged artery to a heart attack. And as I said, I was eating hamburgers almost every day. So that really, sparked me to give up hamburgers and hot dogs and meat for a week. And then I continued, but I started to read what was available at the time. And this is 10 years before we had the internet. And so that's how it started for me, really, that one lecture.
It's amazing because so many people I talk to, it is a lecture, whether Gary Yourofsky, but it's so interesting how one lecture, in my husband's case, hearing Dr. McDougall, can change the trajectory of a life forever. And I remember Dick Gregory from like 50 years ago. I remember reading his book, and I loved the way he diffused anger with humor. And when you talk about the state of the plate, the state of the state is the state of the plate. They're connected intimately, especially now with this virus. It's because of what people are putting on their plates.
That's exactly right. I mean, there were people talking about it, you know, way back when. I mean, he learned about it from Dr. Alvenia Fulton. She learned about it from others. There were others in the civil rights movement. Rosa Parks was a vegetarian. Coretta Scott King, Dexter King. Yes, I mean, these connections were interrelated. They cannot be disconnected. And absolutely, it was really amazing for me to be able to learn about it in that way. And his book, Cooking with Mother Nature, that you're referencing, I think it came out in 73. I modeled my first book, By Any Greens Necessary, in 2010 after that style, because I wanted it to be conversational and to make it plain and be down to earth, to make it an easy read to really spark people's imagination, you know, just imagining that they could, that it was accessible and they could go vegan too.
Did you ever have any more contact with Dick Gregory after that initial meeting? He must be so proud of what you turned into.
He helped so many people. I mean, he heard about this. He heard that so many times, but he was very gracious. I got to tell him a couple of times, and then his son was my chiropractor. And once I told his son, you know, that I, about the story, and I had my book with me, and he said, oh, okay, well, I want you to go into my office. And I went to his office, and Dick Gregory was sitting there in his office. And I sat with him for more than an hour and just, you know, thanked him again and basically listened to him. I had my book, I gave it to him. And it was phenomenal. It was an amazing experience. So yes, I got a chance to tell him for sure.
Oh my God, you got to meet your hero. That must be incredible. Tell us about these 10,000 Black women going vegan. Have you achieved that number? How are you doing this? It sounds like a very worthy project. And how can we support it?
Oh, thank you, AJ. So we are at about 7,300 women now who have signed up. It's a free online program, and it starts officially in October, and we are going vegan together online as a community. And so for the month of October, November, December, and January, we will be going vegan together for 21 days. And I have a whole program, online program around that. And so I actually created this because I'm celebrating the 10th anniversary of By Any Greens Necessary, my first book, and I wanted to do something kind of big and bold. I'm proud to say it was a very influential book. And so for the anniversary, I wanted to do something, you know, equally kind of big. And so I thought helping 10,000 more women go vegan in 1 year. And so I launched it before COVID in February. And and moved the launch date back to October, which, as Robert reminded me, is World Vegan Month. So it's, you know, it's appropriate. And we have already about 7,300 women signed up. I believe that we'll before the start of the program, and then during the program, we'll have more than 10,000 women signed up. So it's exciting. I'm just really grateful that folks are interested.
That's going to be amazing. Well, that would probably be the time to have your mom on, or have you and your mom on again to talk about this, so we can get, if in case you don't meet that 10,000, we'll get as many people as we can. So what's the prerequisite to be enrolled in this program?
You just sign up. I mean, it's a free online program. You go to buynecessary.com or 10,000blackveganwomen.com goes to the same place and sign up. And when you sign up, you immediately download a Weekend Vegan 2-day guide with recipes and a meal plan, grocery shopping list done for you. So you can go vegan right away and be inspired by yourself, inspire yourself that you can do this. And then you get weekly nutrition tips and inspiration from me leading up to the launch of the program. So we're about 60 days out. So we're getting ready to really gear up for the countdown.
That's terrific. Tell me about the Black Women's Health Initiative.
So the Black Women's Health Initiative is a national organization that is, it was and probably still is the largest health organization. It may have a run for its money with Girl Trek now, but it is basically was created to help improve the health of the 24 million Black women and girls in this country. And I had the opportunity to serve as a nutrition advisor when they were creating an anti-obesity program about 2007, 2008. And I created a plant-based curriculum for that program to help nationally, to help Black women learn more about plant-based nutrition to help prevent obesity. And also, you know, want the same diet is also helpful for diabetes prevention, certain cancers. So it was, you know, it was an incredible opportunity because, you know, back then they wanted to really focus on plant-based nutrition, which, you know, wasn't as explosive and popular as it is now.
There's a couple of questions. If you have to be Black and a woman to participate.
It is an online program. It's a free online program for Black women. Absolutely.
So if somebody's not Black or not a woman, they shouldn't sign up.
Well, I mean, it's for Black, a free online program for Black women. That's what I keep.
Okay. Well, you know what? A couple of people posted, so I just wanted to be very, very clear about that.
Yeah, and that's my answer. I mean, you know, it's a free online program. It is, I created it for Black women to celebrate the book, but also because, you know, we're fabulous. You know, we're leaders in so many ways, progressive in so many progressive areas, but we experience the highest rates of chronic diseases. And so this is needed. It's needed to that Black women be focused on. We have the highest rates of diabetes, of unhealthy weight, of certain cancers like ovarian and breast cancers. We get them at early ages. We get them more aggressively. We die sooner. Systemic white supremacy is the underlying cause for all of these conditions, whether it's health, food justice, housing, education, all of it. This should not be a surprise to folks, but it is, something that is real and something that we can take back control of. And so that's why I focus on Black women, because it's needed.
Right. So I guess the question is, for someone that's not Black or a woman, how can we also support you in your work?
Please, just as you're doing, AJ, please help spread the word. I thank you for asking that question and making me answer that particular question. I really appreciate it. Please spread the word on your social media networks to anyone you know. Just let them know that, you know, the program exists. It's absolutely free. And there's a community around supporting them going vegan for at least 21 days. And I'm hoping that people will continue to do it October, November, December, and January so that they can really, you know, dig in and go vegan. So just spread the word. I would love that. Thank you.
Of course. So I totally agree with you about the disparity. But my question is once these tastes have been set, especially in the younger children, because your book is By Any Greens Necessary. And you talk about how it's not your genes, it's whether or not you eat greens. I found, because I have done some volunteer work in these places, and I find that even when you give them the delicious food, they don't like it right away.
Yeah, I didn't either. And because I didn't, I don't, that doesn't stop me, and I don't really worry about it. You know what I mean? You must still introduce children to these foods, right? You have to do that. And I don't know any parent who wants their child to be unhealthy. I don't know any parent who wants their child to be unhealthy. They just have different information. And so introducing them to these tastes, to these foods, to these recipes, is really important, because oftentimes it's not going to be available elsewhere. And if they don't like greens, then try a smoothie. You know what I mean? We know that there's so many delicious types of plant-based foods. If greens aren't the thing for them at the moment, start with something that's more familiar that they might like. I worked with the DC public school system right around the time that I published or that I was writing By Any Greens Necessary, and created a plant-based curriculum for the DC public school system, K-12. And I started with the young ones with couscous. I started with couscous with mixed vegetables and raisins and smoothies. They loved it. They started calling me couscous lady. Start with what they like. You know what I mean? You just keep going. There's so many options to choose from. So yeah, don't be deterred.
Absolutely. You know, when I was listening to a podcast with both you and your mother, she was talking about how early on she was a sugar addict. The fact that she didn't want those foods in the house, do you think that made a difference to your health growing up? Because I know at my house, it was just like a 7-Eleven.
Yeah, it did. It made a huge difference. I mean, we didn't have, we had no sodas growing up. We didn't have a candy bowl. We didn't have a cookie jar. If we had dessert, it was maybe once a week. If we ate out, it was maybe once a week. Total cereal, skim milk, whole wheat bread. So yes, it absolutely made a difference. I mean, I was familiar with the idea of healthy food. I don't remember ever not cooking. My mother was divorced, and I was the youngest of, I am the youngest of three girls. And so we were cooking, and dinner was ready when she got home. You know what I mean? And it was all from scratch. So yes, that's how I grew up, with home cooked meals that were healthier as an omnivore. So when I heard that Dick Gregory lecture, it absolutely, you know, was familiar to me, the idea of healthy food, right? Not veganism and vegetarianism. So my mother did plant that earlier seed. And, you know, she grew up in Camden, South Carolina. And I always say that, you know, we may not have been plant exclusive, but we were plant rich, plant based. Vegetables, grains were always a big part of African American cuisine, and African cuisine as well. So, that definitely made a difference.
Were there any other family members? Did you have any siblings growing up?
I have two older sisters, and one of my sisters went vegan with us at the same time. She was a senior at Tufts University when I was a sophomore at Amherst and heard the lecture. So when we both came home for the summer and to DC with my mom, we all read the same books after that Dick Gregory lecture. My oldest sister, who's 5 years older, was already out of school. And my oldest sister is not vegan and is extremely supportive. And, you know, she's probably on her own, sold more books, told more people about books, her coworkers, that kind of thing. I mean, you know, just really supportive. And just has not made the decision to go vegan. And what we learned from that, or what I should say I learned from that, you know, being vegan for 33 years, we're a very close family. We do, you know, we eat together all the time, is just that as adults, everyone may not make this decision, but to be available and accessible and a resource, and just to know that, you know, just to understand, you know, I guess it helped to soften my self-righteousness, because just to understand that everyone isn't going to make that choice.
Maybe your sister could join the challenge in October.
Yeah, of course. Maybe she will.
Yeah. And that'd be amazing. That'd be amazing. So yeah. did you always want to write books?
Yes. Writing is my first love. Absolutely. I mean, I made books as a kid, like played with dolls and made books. So yes, I've always wanted to write. I knew I'd be writing books, and I plan to write more, whether or not they're vegan specific or they're how to and why to go vegan. There will probably be more of those, but you know, I want to write a great fiction novel. I want to write more nonfiction. Yes, I couldn't live without writing. Okay. Yeah.
Lori says, do you have a summer camp or after school care curriculum?
No, you mean for plant-based nutrition?
I'm not sure, Lori, maybe you can specify. Yeah.
If that's, you know, what you're speaking of, I am on the advisory board of Healthy School Food, which was founded by Amy Hamlin. I'm sure you know about it, AJ. And, they have curricula for, parents and for school systems. So I would strongly suggest getting in touch with Healthy School Food. I think they're at healthyschoolfood.org, and they'll have information for you ready made.
That's terrific. So yeah. A couple of people watching, like Catherine said, they're buying your books just to support you. Tell us about your different books.
By Any Greens Necessary, the first one that came out in 2010, the subtitle, I have it here, A Revolutionary Guide for Black Women Who Want to Eat Great, Get Healthy, Lose Weight, and Look Fat. And that's PHAT, which has, you know, it's an acronym for pretty healthy and thick. So it just means curvy. And wrote that book because Toni Morrison, one of my two favorite writers, the other being James Baldwin, said, if there's a book that you want to read and it hasn't been written yet, then you must write it. And a book had not been written at the time that was focused on Black women. And so that's a book that I would have wanted when I started in the 80s. So I wrote that book. I'm proud to say that book and Sister Vegan, which was a collection of essays that came out a few months by Black vegan women that came out a few months before mine, the same year, have been very influential in helping to popularize veganism among African Americans in this generation. So the second book, Ageless Vegan, is the one that I wrote with my mom. And that is a celebration of our 30 years of being vegan. And it's 100 of our favorite recipes, and they're all whole food plant-based. So that's the latest one.
Let's see. Did you or your mom or anyone in your immediate family ever struggle with weight issues or health issues?
Not really. I mean, I gained that 25 pounds my first year in college. So I was bigger, but I've always kind of had a lanky frame. My father was like 6'4" and thin. So I kind of had that kind of frame. So no, you know, I lost that weight effortlessly when I went vegan. My two sisters and my mom, we've always been thin. And, but that doesn't mean that we have not had eating issues, right? So my mom was thin, hourglass shape, but was addicted to sugar, you know? I growing up, even though with, you know, my mom was giving us healthier food, I had cousins who had a lot of the food that I liked, sodas and chips and, you know, that kind of thing. And I became addicted to sugar, I think, as a kid, like most kids do. I was drinking sodas at school, eating donuts, eating M&Ms before class, you know, that kind of thing. And, you know, loving cheese and fatty food. So, I was fortunate that I didn't have health issues, but I easily could have been going down that road had it not been for that lecture by Dick Gregory my sophomore year.
That's amazing. Just have to take a moment to thank Daryl Woodruff and Linda Middlesworth for using the super chat feature for supporting the show. And Linda actually says, Tracy, will you help her write a book? She's a prominent vegan in her 70s in Sacramento. I don't know if you've heard of her.
Yes, absolutely. Email me, Tracye@byanygreensnecessary.com. But you have the expert here too.
You're so kind. Amy says, what is your favorite meal?
Ooh, my favorite meal, anything Thai. I love, love, love Thai food. Anything coconut curry. Love it, love it. I also love Ethiopian food and Mexican food. You know, obviously I love soul food. I grew up on that with, you know, eating that with Celebration. So that's a default. But I would, and probably my favorite fruit is mango. So anything with mango in it. In the book, we have a mango lawsuit, which I just love.
That's amazing. So Elisa says her biggest struggle as a vegan is children who crave the junk and get it wherever they can. What is your recommendation, Tracye, to encourage young people to not only know what is right, but to do what is right?
I would suggest getting some books. There are, the author's name, AJ, you probably know, but the author's name is escaping me, but there's a woman who has written several, there are actually quite a few people who've written children's books for vegan kids. So stories and how and why to go vegan for kids. So I would definitely look up those. And, you know, these are beautiful picture books. So get those. And read those with your kids and actually let them understand why veganism is a good thing. And if there are vegan groups in your area and you're not a member, see if those groups have family groups. Here in DC, we have the Vegetarian Society of DC, and they actually have family groups. So kids, vegan kids can get together and socialize and hang out and cook together. And then just as a family, it's really important to model what you want your kids to do. And you may already be doing that. But if you are, and they are still not interested, as I said before, find the things that they like and maybe go to bridge foods for those. So if your kids like pizza, have vegan pizza and make it as healthy as you can. You can get a whole grain crust. You don't have to use vegan cheese. You can use other toppings. But if you want to go the vegan cheese, you know, vegan pepperoni route, that those are bridge foods. Those are options as well. But what do your kids like? You know, what are the things that they, do they like grape soda? Do they like orange drink? You know, do they like fruity drinks, make smoothies? What kinds of foods do they like, and see how you can veganize them and be a model? Always have a fruit bowl, always have, you know, fresh, raw snack vegetables available, fresh cut vegetables available, carrot, celery, cauliflower, with an almond butter dip or some kind of, you know, tasty sauce that they can dip it in. Always have those two things available freely, just like you would, you know, a cookie jar or a candy bowl.
Absolutely. Yeah, you know, dips are really the sauce in every cuisine when you think about it.
It's all about the sauces with any cuisine, whether you're omnivore or vegan. So, and the sauces usually are vegan anyway, period. So absolutely. Find out what they like and go through. So there are also kids' cookbooks. Go through them with your kids. Get some family or kids' cookbooks that are vegan and go through the pictures and have your kids pick out what they want to make.
Absolutely. Yeah. Nikki says, how do you approach people, or what do you say to people that complain about their health but continue to eat the same way that made them sick in the first place?
That's a good question. If you're talking about adults, again, you know, we're grown and everyone is not on the same path and everyone is not ready at the same time. So compassion, first and foremost, focus on yourself and understand that there are people who are farther along this vegan and health path than you and people who are not as far along, right? So it depends on how vested you are in this person. Is this a friend? Is this a family member? Is this a coworker? Is this somebody who's just annoying? You know what I mean? That you don't interact with much. Depends on how vested you are. But if it's someone who you truly want to help, I would say compassion first And you may want, and if they ask you help them cook, if they ask you for book suggestions, video suggestions, give them those suggestions. But if they don't, you can simply say something like, well, you know, I'm gonna have some vegan suggestions for you if you want, if they're complaining about their health issues. And, you know, because that's the healthiest way to eat, would you like me to share some of those with you? And just keep saying that. And either they're going to take up those suggestions or they're going to be like, I'm tired of hearing about this vegan stuff, so I'm going to stop talking about it. But, you know, as adults, you have to understand that, you know, just because you know it's important and you know it's urgent doesn't mean that the folks you're interacting with are going to get it at that time. So have compassion is what I say.
Great.
I hope
that's very helpful. People are saying maybe the author you were thinking of is Ruby Roth.
Yes. I actually have her books too.
Yeah, yes. I'm going to get in touch with her. She'll make a great guest. Sharon says, yeah. How do you recommend handling the holidays?
I'm assuming that you're gathering with extended family members and most of them are omnivores. So my family has been having Thanksgiving since before I was born together, my extended family, lots of folks. And so we bring our vegan food. Early on, 33 years ago, we were vegan evangelists. And, you know, like, here's our food, eat this food, don't eat that ham, da 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 da. And we got teased. And then a few years of that, we just said, you know what? We're just going to bring our food. We're going to put it on another table so there's no cross mixing of spoons and serving utensils. And we'll bring enough for us and a little extra. And if folks want some, they can have some. But we're just going to make our plates and sit and eat with everybody. And if they ask us, you know, why are you eating that food? Or why aren't you eating the mac and cheese? Why aren't you eating the fried chicken? Why aren't you eating the collard greens with the pork in it or the turkey bacon or whatever? We just, you know, over the years found that it was good for us to say, oh, you know, yeah, we're still eating this way. Yeah, you know, we're still feeling good. And if they persist, well, why are you doing it? Why aren't you eating this? We'd say, oh, we'll talk about it later. Because what we found is that they may be defensive or they may be genuinely interested, but everybody in the table may not want to hear about feces on chicken, right? Like if we're going to tell the truth, that's not, you know, it's not always the time while people are eating. So we would just repeatedly say, oh, we can talk about it later. We can talk about it later. And if they came up to us after we ate, then we would really talk about it and share resources. But you choose your battles. You don't have to answer every question at the time that it's asked. You can decide when you're comfortable talking about it because you are part of that conversation as well. So don't be on the defensive. Don't feel also self-righteous. And, you know, do it in a way that's comfortable for you. But the more you are at ease and relaxed and confident, the more that will be reflected in the way that your family members interact with you truly. Because after 33 years, we don't get teased anymore. Our family members have come to us and asked us to help them eat vegan. They're very supportive. They see that my mother from 50 to 80 has maintained her health, has maintained her weight. And most of my mother's siblings who have survived into their senior years have not, even some of their kids. So, you know, we are living examples of this, and that speaks very loudly as well. So that's.
Thank you. Just want to thank Jennifer Mayer for supporting the show. And Sharon also wanted to know, do you recommend trying to persuade family members or like you say, just leave them alone?
Yeah, I mean, so it's weird. Maybe weird isn't the word, but this is my profession, right? So I, by default, and when I'm off, I'm off. I really don't want to talk about it when I'm not working, right? Just like, I guess, someone who's a tax lawyer or whatever, you know, when you're off and you just want to enjoy family and not talk about these things. So I'm not pressed to try to persuade and influence when I'm not working. I really have to be asked about it. And then again, I'm not going to do it while we're at the dinner table, at the big dining room table, where we're at our little card tables or whatever. I'm going to wait and say, okay, let's talk about it later. That was me early on. Everybody in my family knows what I do. After 33 years, they know, you know, I think they've asked all the questions. You know what I mean? But so again, because it's my profession and I do it all the time, I want to be off. I don't want to be engaged in these conversations all the time. So I'm not going to be the one to start that conversation. If this was not my profession, I may be more inclined to do it, but probably not. I probably would wait and be asked about it, you know, but I don't have any problem talking about it if I am asked about it. You know, so that's my answer. Again, we're talking about adults who are gonna, you know, we have different information, but we choose when we engage in these conversations with other adults, right? And you choose what's comfortable for you and what will make you calm and relaxed and not defensive.
Nice. Kay wants to know what your skincare routine is because you have gorgeous skin. And I was just curious if people just ever come up to you and say they can't believe your age and you look so good. And then that's an opportunity to say, well, you know, it's because I'm vegan.
Thank you so much for that. I appreciate it. And I'm not a product kind of person. So I really thank you for that compliment. It's really my diet, whole food, plant-based. I try to do dark leafy greens at least 3 times a day. So whether that's in a smoothie in the morning or you know, some powdered wheatgrass with lemon water, dark green leafy salad for lunch, and then some kind of greens as part of my meal, you know, in a wrap or stir fry for dinner, and lots of water. But also, I use an oil like argan oil and with rose oil. And I just wash my face and put oil on it. I'm not really, that's really all I do. I'm not a product junkie. Yeah. So, yeah.
But they say they have beautiful teeth too. So you're doing something right.
Thank you. Hate that. And yes, AJ, I'm sure you get this all the time too. People are surprised when you tell them, when they find out your age, when you tell them your age, and it is definitely an opportunity to tell them what you do, because healthy aging should be the norm, right?
Absolutely. When I turned 60 this year, Janine Elder designed a shirt for me that I love wearing that says, this is what 60 looks like when you're vegan.
There you go.
Absolutely. Thanks. And thank you, Karen Thomas, for your super chat contribution and supporting the show. So Sharon wanted to know, where does somebody find very healthy soul food recipes? Because there's some people here follow the eating plan of Dr. Esselstyn, don't include oil. So are there some very healthy soul food recipes available for people?
Absolutely. And oil, and you know, AJ, as you know, oil is not necessary in the diet. Poured oils, you can saute, you can make wonderful sauces without them, and you can definitely have oil-free soul food. So in our book, for example, we say that you can use oil or water when you saute. Oil is optional. It's just for liquid or flavor in many recipes. So absolutely, it's not necessary. So you can check out our book. You can check out Bryant Terry's books. You can check out Janae Peterson's book. There are actually quite a few folks who are doing vegan soul food. So either, you know, they are already making it healthier, or, you know, hopefully we'll have tips about how you can substitute and not water for oil in the cooking and the sauces.
If your mom is 84, does she have a lot of friends left her age? And was she able to influence any of her peers?
Good question. Yes. I mean, you know, as I said, my mom before COVID was going to her senior center 6 days a week. And so she likes to tell this, you know, and you know, there are always folks telling my mom, oh, you don't look your age. You know, you're so fit and healthy. And she is all of those things. And but she's always talking about women who are in their 90s or their 100s. who are in the senior center at in her exercise classes. So she is looking up to them. So yes, there are, you know, she has a community of seniors of different ages at her senior center that she walks to or drives to twice a day that she's in community with. And now they're doing classes online. Most of them are not vegan. And my mother is like me. If they ask, she will definitely talk about her veganism, and they ask often. And when she brings in snacks for when she teaches quilting for someone's birthday, any kind of occasion, it's always vegan, of course. And she's had me talk to her senior center. We've talked together when our book came out, I think at least three or four times. So yes, she's definitely sharing the message.
That's great. Other than Dick Gregory, is there anybody that's influenced your journey along the way?
Yes, absolutely. Victoria Moran was a very early influence on me. I love Victoria. And let's see, gosh, that Caldwin Esselstyn, now you got me stuck trying to remember people's names. But yes, absolutely. I mean, the gurus that we know who are now seniors and have been doing it for more than 30 years, for sure. And I will say that for me in particular, there is a large Black vegan community and has been in DC and has been since the 70s that I knew nothing about before I went vegan. And in my junior year, I took away from Amherst. So I went to Nairobi, Kenya the first semester. The second semester, I went to DC. I went to Howard University in DC, and I found out about this Black vegan community. And so there were folks in this community who had been vegan since the 50s and 60s and 70s. And there were 14 100% vegan establishments in the city at that time in the 80s. And they were the only 100% vegan establishment. So I learned from this community how to be vegan, why to be vegan, how to make it affordable and delicious. So these are my mentors, right? And there's so many of them. And even there's some that I see today who are like 20 and 30 years older than me that are still vegan and looking fabulous. And I'm like, I hope that will be me.
I'm pretty sure it will. You're well on your way. So I think that's a given. So let's see I'm just looking for questions. Okay. Well, I'm going to ask the difficult one because people are asking, but just to reiterate, people that join late, you're 54. Is that correct?
I will be 54 next month. Yeah.
Nice. Wonderful. So if you're in DC, do you ever see Dr. Mills?
Oh, of course.
Okay.
A lot.
I love him. He is the best laugh of any human in the world. That's so cool that you get to hang out with him. Gosh, that's great. All right. You work together.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. He's one of my favorites. He's just adorable. So Jay says, can Tracy please explain how white supremacy is the reason for Black disparity? I don't understand because we both shop at the same grocery stores.
We shop at the... Oh, I don't know what the last part of the question means.
Okay, well, then just the first one. There's just the first part, and then maybe she can clarify the second part.
Okay, well, you know, this country the institutions are based on systemic white supremacy. White supremacy, capitalism, patriarchy, that should be a default that we all agree, that we all know is the foundation of this country. And it affects every aspect of life. So not only was there enslavement, there was for 250 years, some people call it Jim Crow, but it was actually state sanctioned terror against Black people, right? For another 100 plus years. I was born in 1966. The Voting Rights Act was in 1965, right? There was legal segregation when I was born. My mother grew up in that. So not only were Black folks enslaved and then terrorized, but there were specific federal and state and local policies that denied Black people equal housing, equal education. equal jobs, equal access to every important aspect of American life. So not only were we denied, but white people were given preference. There were policies that gave white people access to housing, access to education, access to jobs. So these things were happening simultaneously, right? That's the disparity. That's the inequity. So we are not just talking about now trying to be equal. We're talking about equity, which is something that my mother talks, you know, has talked about often. It's not just equality, it's equity, because you must take into account that there has been 400 years of systemic denial and inequity, right? For that this government has done to Black people, and systemic privilege and promotion that has been done to white people, right? That is the basis of the inequity and the disparity that we are still dealing with now. The only real way to deal with that is reparations, right? That's it. Because otherwise this gap will increase generation and generation and generation and generations from now. It will just continue and increase. So that's the bottom line. So it doesn't matter if you have a neighbor and y'all both shop at Whole Foods. You're talking about, you know, two individuals, two anecdotal stories. We're talking about a system that was based, that's based on 400 years. There's a lot there. That's in a nutshell.
So again, what can we do? That's what I want to know. What can we do? How can we help?
Well, I mean, you know, Black folks have been vegans and pioneers in veganism and leaders in veganism for generations. So, you know, I would just suggest if you want to help folks in particular, Black communities in particular, then find out what Black organizations exist that have been doing this work that, you know, and in the way that you want to help. So whether it's a community garden, whether it's a grocery store, whether it's a pantry, whether it's schools, whether it's, you know, supporting and or volunteering with a nonprofit that was founded by Black folks, particularly to help other African Americans, find out what's going on in your community. As I said in my conversation with Robert a few days ago, assume abundance. Assume that people have been doing this, and assume that, you know, there are organizations that you can be a part of and help those folks do their work in whatever way that they are seeking help, right? That's and whether that's an African American community, a Latinx community, an Asian American community, a Native American Indigenous community. There are already resources and communities and organizations that are doing this work. So contact them and find out from them how you can support them.
Terrific. And your program specifically, Judy, wants to know, we send people to Buy Any Greens Necessary, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. BuyAnyGreensNecessary.com. And just let folks know that the program, it's a free program that's available. And you know, we're starting in about 60 days.
Okay. Great. And so how are you spreading the word, just by coming on shows like this and telling people, or is there another way we can?
Yeah. Doing media, social media. Going on local television, being in magazines. So I have a publicist that I'm working with. We've gotten lots of media, but definitely that in social media and just my networks. And we've gotten funding so that I'm able to do it, you know, to offer the program for free, because I want to make it as accessible as possible. But just, you know, just spreading the word. And again, we're at about 7,300 women already.
All right, guys, you know, we have that many more followers on YouTube. If everybody shared this, we'll get her let's get her the 2,700 by the end of the week. What do you say? You guys got me to 100,000. Let's get Tracye to 10,000. If we all watching today literally shared with 10 people, she'd be at 10,000. Do you hear that? Yeah. Great. That's amazing. Well, that's what I love about this show, is that's, I love seeing people be successful in whatever. That's why we say, how can I support you? And that's, I love making other people's dreams a reality. That's the funnest thing for me. So you sort of answered this, Tracye, a little bit, but she asked it, and maybe it's possible she tuned in late. But Sandra says, "Hi, I'm having a hard time convincing my African-American family and friends to eat whole food plant-based. They'll try some of my vegan dishes, but feel the ingredients are unfamiliar and nasty. Any suggestions?" Nasty.
Yeah. Funny. So a lot of that is, you know, could be, you know, our American addiction to fat, salt, and sugar, right? And it might take a few weeks for people's palates to change, but that would mean that they'd have to eat vegan mostly. So it sounds like that you'd have a hard time at this point trying to get people to do that in your family. So I would say, like, what are the foods that they like? What are the foods that they're eating already? And veganize versions of those. So, and it also depends on what city you're living in. And we're in COVID. It also depends on what's available for pickup and or delivery. But try vegan soul food. And even if, you know, it has higher amounts of fat, salt, and sugar, you're right now just trying to get people to understand that there can be vegan versions of the foods that they like, right? So you can check out my book, Ageless Vegan. You can check out Bryant Terry's vegan soul food cookbooks, Janae Peterson's vegan soul food cookbooks. There are quite a few others as well. So we're online. Our recipes are online. In our cookbooks, you can get them from the bookstore, the library. But just let folks know that there are vegan versions of the foods that they like. And depending on what those foods are, I'm going to assume soul food, but it could be Mexican, Caribbean, Italian, you know, find out what the foods are that they like, right, and introduce them to vegan versions.
Well, one of the things that is asked to just about every guest, because the viewers want to know, is what did Tracye eat on a daily basis? And what do you do for exercise? And what do you do for fun? And if you're watching anything great on Netflix or Amazon Prime these days?
Oh, sure. So I will have a green smoothie, oatmeal, or a fruit bowl, you know, a smoothie bowl for breakfast. I will have usually a wrap and a salad for lunch, and that wrap might have some curry chickpeas in it, avocado, roasted peppers, you know, orange or red bell peppers, onions, garlic, olives, probably some black rice, you know, and a whole grain wrap. I love, love, love wraps. And I might, you know, put some sauce that I've made on it, some spread with a kale salad or an arugula salad, or a cabbage salad, some kind of raw salad with dark leafy greens. And then for dinner, it's probably going to be like some kind of stir fry. I love eggplant stir fry with almond butter sauce. I love broccoli stir fry, mixed vegetable stir fries over pasta, over quinoa, over millet. That's pretty much, you know, how I eat. And if I'm, you know, gonna snack, it's gonna be probably, you know, some whole grain crackers, some, you know, handful of nuts and almonds, cashews, pecans, dates. Pretty, you know, pretty simply I eat.
What do you
if
use?
I'm out, oh. That's different.
What do you use to dress your greens, if anything, or your salads?
Oh, to dress my greens, it depends. So if I'm making like sometimes I'll squeeze lime or I'll squeeze lemon on it, nutritional yeast. Sometimes I'll make like a Caesar salad, a Caesar dressing or an almond butter sauce. So it, you know, it just depends on what I'm feeling like that day.
Well, the reason I asked is because every guest on this show that lives in the United States gets 2 free bottles of my favorite vinegar, California balsamic, so that you might enjoy those on your salads and your greens. This has a new flavor that came out in August called 7 Herb Italian that I hope you'll try.
Oh, AJ, you're the best. Thank you.
Well, thank you. That's because I have the best guests and I have the best viewers. like Susan Johnston, who not only gifted me with this bell, but just did a super chat support of the show. So I really appreciate that. So what do you do in your spare time? Do you exercise? Do you read? Do you Netflix? What do you do in your downtime?
All of the above. I do yoga and I exercise. I usually do some kind of dancing around the house, you know, as my own form of aerobics because we're in COVID, and I take walks every day. I live near a beautiful park. So I walk around the park. I try to walk for at least 40 minutes to an hour every day in the mornings. And for fun, I love to read. I mean, I love to travel. I love to go to museums. I love to go to shows. Obviously, I can't do that. So, you know, right now it's reading, talking to friends on the phone and Zoom, and listening to books on tape. And then on Hulu, I'm watching Living Single from the 90s, which is one of my favorite shows. And Girlfriends will be coming to Netflix soon, so I'll be watching that. So yeah, I do binge watch Grace and Frankie, Kim's Convenience. Oh my gosh,
I love the last two are the ones I love. Absolutely. I just started a new show called I'm Sorry that's now on Netflix. It's hilarious. It's so
okay.
Yeah. Do you get to hang out with Dr. Barnard at all, being so close to the Barnard Medical Center?
I mean, before COVID, I would see Neil quite a bit. They did an event for us for our Ageless Vegan book when we were on book tour. I've been on the podcast and Facebook Live with PCRM a couple of times this year. So yes, I've definitely seen Neil before COVID and talked to him. And the center is awesome. The Barnard Center, fantastic.
It's amazing. You live by two of my favorites, Dr. Mills and Dr. Barnard. I just can see you having them over for dinner sometime, you know?
Yeah, well, I haven't done that, but that's a good idea.
Well, if I lived in DC, that would be the first thing I did was invite those two over, and maybe a few others of the great people that work at the Barnard Medical Center. Well, you have been an absolute delight to talk to. I hope you'll come back with your mom, or maybe your mom wants to do it herself. It's totally up to you. And now with the numbers we have now, if everybody, you only have to get 9 people to sign up for 10,000 Black vegan women, and she'll be done. And then she can watch her shows, guys. So help her out. And I thank you guys so much for watching. And I also want to thank Elspeth, who gave me this shirt. These are the most unusual arms I've ever seen on a shirt. I feel like I'm going to fly away, but I thank you for your support. And Tracy, thank you so much for the wonderful work that you're doing. And if we can support you in any way, please let us know. And I hope to see you back here soon with your mom.
Thank you so much, AJ. I really appreciate it. Thank you for all you do.
The pleasure's been all mine. And guys, come back in 1 hour when we have Thomas Allen from California Balsamic making recipes with balsamic vinegar that Tracy's going to get 2 free bottles from. Take care, Tracy. Bye-bye.